We'll be right back. Thanks a lot, Knuckle! It's taken from the Frost album. You guys enjoy that album? Alright, that's good. This one is called Jotun Blue. Thank you very much. All right, Poland. This next one is taken from the Monumention album. This one is called The Voices.
Oh,
All right, Draco. This next one is a new one. This one is called As Fire Swept Clean the Earth. Michael. All right. I guess you guys are ready for some old stuff. Something from the first album. All right, yes, exactly. This one is called Heim Dublin.
Ah!
much. Glad you all like that old shit. We have another old one coming up for you guys. This one is called Luke. Next one is a new one, which is called Queen of Night.
Still.
Alright, this next one is an instrumental. It's a title track from the Mardröm album. Mardröm, Beyond the Within. Thanks a lot, Krakow. All right. This next one is a new one as well. This one is called Ridicule Swarm. Thank you very much, Krakow! Right, this next one is called Wu-Tang! Song from an excellent death metal band from the United States called Autopsy. This one is called Retribution for the Dead.
Free revenge.
Thanks a lot. Before we play the last song, I will use the opportunity to introduce the band. There's some new faces. Eivind on keyboards. Arne on lead guitar. Dirge Rep, as usual, on drums. Ivar Bjørnsson, as always, on guitar.
Good
luck. It's an old classic. This one is taken from the split CD with Emperor in 93. This one is called Slaget I skogen bortenfor. Thank you very much, Crackle. Good night.
What influenced you to play metal music?
Phobia started with it was me and a guy called Henford Hansen. He's now playing in Theater of Tragedy. We wanted to start playing death metal because that was our main influence back then. And we were, you know, only two guys, and for approximately 5 or 6 months we were searching for a guitar player, and suddenly we heard about a 12-year-old guy from a small village outside the place where we lived, and that was Ivar. And we contacted him, and he was interested immediately. And we were like influenced by bands like Autopsy, early Dark Throne, Carcass, early Entombed, and yeah, other good death metal stuff.
The name Enslave, is it true that it was invited by Demonas of Immortal?
When we split Phobia, we decided to split the band. I think it was around the same time that we formed Enslaved. It was me and Ivar from Phobia, and a drummer called Trym Thorsson, now in Emperor, no, Cyclone. And we were searching for a name, we were searching for a cool name, and Immortal had a track back then called Enslaved in Rot. So Demonas just asked us, why not use it, the name Enslaved? And we thought it was pretty cool. And, yeah. That's it.
Good evening, Krakow!
There were a few drummers in the band. What's so special in that instrument? I mean, why have you changed the drummers?
It's like a Spinal Tap or something. Or it's got nothing to do with the instrument itself, I guess. It was just a coincidence. For Trym's part, it was he wasn't really part of, wasn't agreeing on how we should make the direction. But it was not like it was a very easy split up, you know. We simply saw that this is, we're not, the three of us is not going in the same direction. So he wanted to go his own ways, we want to do our things. So we asked him to leave, and a few seconds later he joined the Emperor, you know, so it was no big deal. Then we had Harald Helgeson, which was a good thing for the album, Eld. But he was never a drummer for this kind of music. He's more oriented towards classic heavy metal kind of thing, right?
Yeah. This more kind like of into Dream Theater and stuff like that, so. His style of playing the drums fitted very well on the Eld album, but
I just said that.
Yeah, so.
But so after this album, that's what we could do together, and then we decided we needed a drummer who was really fitting the Enslaved musical and text concept, and Dutch Rap was the one drummer we wanted to have, and lucky as we were, we gave him a call and he said yes.
The first demo was launched in 50 copies. Is it possible to buy it somewhere?
No. It's so incredibly cheesy, so I guess we'll keep it as a secret. You know. It's not good at all. It's just terrible. Both the structure and the songs and the sound and everything is crap, basically. A few good things, but yeah.
It was done too soon after we started, you know. It was just like very non-critical, the first songs. And, but it was, of course, very useful, you know, because it gave us a very clear idea on what was not working for Enslaved.
Breaking point of a band?
That would be Frost, the album Frost. Because, okay, I guess the first mini LP with which is also done on the split CD with Emperor, Horde on the Slum. That was a big thing, because in these days, black metal was just getting started, getting big attention in media and in the music scene. But it was, I think, Frost, which made the big difference for us. Frost and the following tours. And so this will be the main one, and I think we had another one with Maldrum, because this was stating a very clear change of directions in the music, and a more personal and complete concept for everything, from the music, lyrics, artwork, image, the whole thing. And as we received such positive response from this kind of experiment, you know, to go in new directions, I would also say that that would be a kind of an artistic breaking point for the band.
Which album was the most difficult to record?
Yeah, probably.
Yeah. This was, as we spoke about, like the end of Harald Helgeson's, this was the last thing he did in his life, was record this album. So we were obviously heading for a lineup change, people being drunk and stoned and a bit tired, you know, from having worked very intensely from the start in 92, recordings, touring, everything very new for us. I guess some kind of pressure after the Frost album and this kind of thing. But especially this kind of the lineup, you know, it's very strange to be in the studio when you know that the band will not be the same after recording. So it was like the other recordings, of course it went fine and everything was recorded, happy with the result, but this atmosphere, I guess, was not the coolest.
You can say that you have helped to establish Candlelight Records, because they have started with your material.
Yeah, the mini album, the Enslaved mini album, Hordernes Land, were actually the first record released on Candlelight. It was like Candle 001. So, and the split CD was selling well, so it really helped that Candlelight, how should I put it? It really helped them establish a solid record company.
Doubt that the music of Enslaved has been changing all over the years. What made the changes and when did it happen?
It's not a conscious, it's not been a chain of like conscious decisions. It's been more like, as we also spoke about, that the band was very young when it started, and also in a period of time when the music we play, which is strongly related to black metal, sometimes death metal, like the extreme kinds of music, especially black metal was very young at the time when Enslaved started. If you disregard like Bathory, Venom, this kind of stuff, but like the new wave, which started early in the 90s. So the band was shaped in a time where there were very few rules or dogmas on how to do things. So this has always been an advantage for us, which it's followed us a lot. Nowadays, people have a very clear perception of what black metal is in lyrics and music. The guitar should sound like this, the drum should be this, you know, the whole thing. But we come from a time where we kind of had to explore it ourselves to make things, and then see later if it's working or not. And we of course we change as persons, and I think we've always had it as some kind of rule for the band. If we want to do something, we have to follow this desire to do exactly what we feel in the music, to make the albums first and foremost for our own sake. So sometimes, of course, we think, you know, this is very new, how will people react to this? But that has to come in second line. The first thing is we have to do stuff that we feel like doing. So I can't give you an exact time. It's always been there. Like even from Holland's Land, there would be some new elements which was not found in black metal before. On the first album, you could hear some small traces of the experimental psychedelic stuff with the analog synthesizers. So it's been there all the way. Eld was maybe the first one, which is really, really different, I guess.
When you mention CD, could you say it's the most matured material in your career?
That's also difficult to say, because you can say that the mini LP is not so mature, but you have to see this was the time with the first thing we recorded. But maybe. I don't know. I think that's better or easier for other people who follow the band through the years to just make up their mind if they think it sounds mature or anything. You know, it doesn't really matter to us. We don't feel particularly mature or sophisticated or anything. You know, we just want to do we make the songs and get the ideas together and record it. And then I think other people can make. You know, some people think it's mature and other people think it's silly. You know, that's the world.
But it is very much different than the rest of your albums.
Yes. Yeah, I see your point. It's not nothing conscious. It just happens. But I think also, as we had all these small elements from the earlier albums, we reached the point where we wanted to kind of complete it. You know, to take it all the way. To not only have hints and drops of this experimenting, like a few seconds here, a few seconds there, but to kind of like make it complete and see how far we can take the ideas.
Mm. And another thing is that we started back then when we wrote the material from When You Mentioned, we were listening to a lot more than earlier to bands like Pink Floyd, Yes, King Crimson, Rush, progressive bands from the 70s. So that has quite big influence on the material on When You Mention.
The new record, is it a kind of a coming back to old kind of playing?
In a way, yes. It's. We just finished recording it, and we'll be mixing it in a while. So it's, I don't know, it was 1.5 week now or something since we recorded it. So we're still absorbing it. But I think we definitely can state already that it's darker. And the few reactions we've had from people who heard the new stuff live, because we already start to include some stuff in the live set, have also stated that they feel it's more aggressive, even though it's not like blast beat kind of this kind of aggression, you know, but a very hostile, dark and somewhat more cold feeling to both the music and the lyrics. And this could be a reaction to, as we spoke about, Money Mansion being very, very in one direction to complete it. You know, that we feel a need to change again. You know, and. So the older stuff being more aggressive and darker, I guess you can make a connection, yeah. But at the same time, to try and keep the more, the better ways of putting songs together like we did on One Vanishing, but with maybe the stylus, more like the earlier things, I don't know.
And would you call it a kind of a step back?
No, definitely. It's a step. You never know which direction it is. It could be. I think it's kind of a paradox, since it's one step with the atmosphere being more, the mood being darker, it could be said as a step towards the old stuff, but at the same time the music and the way to perform the music is definitely a step forward. So it's more like an expansion than a step, you know, the whole thing is more like growing and including things from the old days at the same time as it's incorporating new things.
Come on, Trevor!
Your lyrics basing on Nordic mythology, what's so special in Nordic mythology that you have decided to base your lyrics on it?
It's very, if you compare ancient religions like, you know, Norse, Celtic and other nature religions, if you compare those religions for example, Christianity, Christianity is more like, to put it in a simple way, you are following a leader, you know, who is making your decisions. The Norse religion is based up on individual choices all the time, so it's a very individual religion based upon self development. So that, you know.
It's kind of more interesting to see what you can do with yourself than to just follow something people wrote 1,000 years ago, which is very not creative.
It's a very free religion, you know. You don't have any. You have more like advices than rules, if you understand what I'm saying.
And what exactly is Ragnarok?
You want to say something?
Yeah. For us, with the music and what we do, it's more that we try to have a personal Ragnarok. That it's more like a consciousness thing to do. That you, what he said about the Norse individualism and self-development, and kind of transcending perhaps positive and negative things, finding both and transcending them into something new. Aleister Crowley said to die daily, which is a simple but genius, occult statement. So I think we're more chaotic and psychedelic with our interpretation of Norse belief. But initiation,
Ragnarok is kind of the last step in the self-development.
Kind of destroying yourself and renewing yourself, and at the same time exploring the reptilian parts of your brain, for instance, or going deeper, going to the fear.
So if you can kind of survive your own Ragnarok, you have created a complete person. You know?
Crossing the abyss or maybe. Yeah.
What message do you like to send with your music, if there is any?
There's no obvious. I said the word obvious a lot in this interview. Let's find a new word. It's there's no textual message in the form of instructions to go and do this or go shopping or drink
churches.
Or drink more or drink less or anything like physical. Thing you can interpret from it. It's more we try to paint out our perception of things, our dreams or hopes, wishes, sorrow, tragedies, whatever. To put it into the music in the best possible way and express it through the mythological metaphors and this kind of stuff. If there's any message, it's more like to inspire people to try and do the same, to look at all the sides of yourself and to accept this destructiveness in terms of personality, to be very self-critical about views, to have absolute opinions about things is very limiting, I think. So it's, if it inspires just like two persons or one person in the world to think more about stuff and to work harder on becoming more satisfied with your own life, it's perfect. One guy can interpret the one lyric in a complete way from the next guy, even though they can live in the same house or anything. So there's no point, we don't have any particular wishes on how people should interpret it. The only limits we say, it's not political, it's not religious. That's the only limitations we have.
What is music?
I think it could be different stuff. You can have, of course, it can be seen as just entertainment in the same way as you can see a painting or a movie or something to make time go faster. Or you can see it as something psychological, like social, psychological, like an escape from your job or everyday life. And of course you have the very like up there explanations, the metaphysical ones, like from Pythagoras' time, that this is a mirroring of brain activity, you know. I think this is I don't really understand that, but it sounds very exciting. It can be it sounds very smart to say it, but it can be, I think there can be some truth in it, that the music can be some kind of good music or honest music or something. It can be an actual reflection of your thought patterns. That would be a nice thing. But I think all three explanations is equally good. It depends on what you wish to believe in, I guess.
The things in your history you would never repeat?
I don't think we'll ever record Blohem again. I was we made the whole thing in 1 week, and it's not finished at all. It's just make it go to the studio and record it. So it's all too fast and too much chaos.
There's a couple of riffs.
So this was the time when Dirt Rap and Kronheim had just joined the band. So even though we had material, it was, as he said, just 1 week in the rehearsal space to put it together. And
Roy was living in London, and he came to Bergen a week before the recording, so everything was done in a big rush, really. I still like parts of it, but you know, as a whole album, it's not that strong.
The cover arts, are they important?
Yes. They always express some part of the music, but more expression has been from the last two albums. It's just much more with the whole lyric and music, and the visual part of it is expressing itself in the cover. Very much with Monumention, there's the whole thing. The whole thing is a package. There's also stuff on the cover that is from connected to each song. Eight items, if you can find them. Like a it's like a game, you know. No, but infotainment. No, but yeah, it's become more and more part of and more integrated. So the whole symbol using and psychedelia that's there, it's very important. Yeah, and the whole Monumention album is the Ragnarok thing we were talking about earlier, and the whole concept behind what he said about Norse belief, and yeah.
Plans for the nearest future of Enslaved?
New album, TBD, of course. Bake some cookies. No. I guess that the main focus is the album and the DVD, and hopefully tour Europe. It's been a long time, and that's what we want to do.
Start working on new stuff.
Yeah.
Which is important, not to stop.